There we go. All right. In this transmission, we've got three on-off solenoids. We've got one right over here, one right here, one right here. And they're visibly small little solenoids. Now, if you look back here, there's a great big silver solenoid that's probably, I don't know, inch in diameter and 2 inches long or so. That's a pulse width modulated solenoid, or Toyota calls it a linear solenoid, but it's pulse width modulated. And so these three solenoids are on-off solenoids. This is a four-speed transmission, and so two of those solenoids are going to do the actual shifting of the four gears. I think they call them solenoid one and solenoid two. Some transmissions call them solenoid A, solenoid B. It doesn't matter. To move two shift valves to make it upshift and downshift, it only takes two solenoids in this style of a transmission. The third solenoid is a torque converter clutch solenoid to engage the torque converter clutch. And then the great big pulse width modulated one is the one that controls the actual pressure inside the transmission, the line pressure. The line pressure is typically pretty low at idle, maybe 50 psi, and can go as high as maybe 250 psi if you rev it way up at wide open throttle. So it's a variable pulse width modulated solenoid. On these valves, though, in the valve body, let's look at the valve here with this solenoid. It's a shift solenoid. Right above that valve, or above this on-off solenoid, is a valve, and I don't know if you can see it, there's a spring. You can't see it. There's a spring up above it, but I'll show you the action of the spring, because I can reach in with this pick. There we go. There we go. So it can go up and it can go down. That's all that thing does. Now, I don't know which way is upshifted and which way is downshifted, but this solenoid right here that hooks to that is going to be a solenoid that is just a little tiny thing like this. It's fairly close in size, but if I blow through it, that's a normally open solenoid. So if this solenoid were plugged in there and there was fluid that came to this point right here and wanted to push up on that valve and push it up against the spring, it wouldn't be able to push. How come? It can't build pressure. The solenoid's open. So it would squirt fluid right out the bottom of that solenoid as it's mounted here. It wouldn't be able to build up pressure, so the spring would keep the valve pushed down. Now, all it's going to take, this only has one wire going to it, so the ground is picked up through the case in the valve body. If all we did was apply battery voltage to that, which is, we say 12 volts, but with the engine running, it's 14, 13 and a half. You apply a voltage to that, it blocks off that passage, and now fluid that comes right here is going to build up pressure and move that valve up. Now, if you look closely at the valve lands, the shiny part of the valve that you see right there is a valve land, and then the recessed part is the valley. Notice that this valve land is blocking this fluid passage right here. Let's say there's fluid that wants to go from this side over to this side. Well, that shiny valve land is blocking that from getting through. But look what happens when we lift up on the solenoid. It opens it up and lets the fluid go through. Now, what if that fluid went to one of those pistons that pushes on the clutch pack that we've been taking apart all week? Does that make sense? So, I've been telling you that the planetary gear sets are controlled by clutches or bands on those really older transmissions. But the clutches are controlled by valves in the valve body. The spring will typically, let's say in this case, I don't know what it is, I'd have to look it up. If the valve is pushed down with the spring pushing on it, just like it is, let's say that's first gear. And then if we could turn on that solenoid and block the fluid and force the valve to go up against the spring pressure and let fluid through from one passage to the other, then that would send fluid to whatever clutch gives us second gear. And then we've got another, there's another shift valve over here, I think, or maybe it's buried underneath over there. It doesn't matter. It's going to look just like this. It's another long valve with a spring. And then we'll move it, and it'll allow us to shift from second to third gear. And then we'll come back to this one. We're going to release it, and that previous valve that shifted us into third gear is going to put oil up in another passage that there was no oil there before. And so now when this valve comes down, it lets fluid go into whatever clutch or band gives us fourth gear. So we just toggle back and forth. One solenoid on upshifts us, the next one upshifts us again, and we have to turn the other one off. There's all sorts of on and off combinations. I've got all these power flow, what are called range reference charts around the shop that show the solenoid on-off status of a lot of the transmissions that we've got out here. But that status is also available in service information. You can find the solenoid. There should be some sort of table that tells you for first gear, solenoid 1 is on, solenoid 2 is off, or whatever it may be. So these solenoids, when you activate them, there should be a click, an audible click. And so I'll have my jumper box out. We're actually going to do some testing of solenoids here in just a minute, but you'll be able to hear the solenoid click. If it clicks, that means electromagnetically, the little plunger that moves up and down inside to block that hole is moving. Now, you can actually have a solenoid that its resistance checks fine, but it doesn't click. It's no good. So you want a solenoid that clicks. You want one that'll change its function from being blocking fluid to letting it through, or letting it through to blocking. And then we want it to hold pressure also. When it's blocking, we don't want it to leak. And they can leak also. So that's some of the valves in the valve body. Some other valves, like this one right here, these are just simply pressure regulators. Now, since the oil pressure in a transmission is related to engine RPM, remember, where's the pump in a transmission? It's right up front, and it's driven off the engine crankshaft. So if you turn a pump slowly at idle, and then you turn it more quickly at higher RPM, you're going to have higher volume and usually higher pressure with it. Well, we can't have pressure going all over the place and precisely control a transmission. So there's these pressure regulator valves that fluid will come to the top of the valve and push down. If it pushes down far enough, it'll just exhaust into the case. And they have a calibrated spring that's, it might take 90 psi to push the spring down enough that it'll bleed into the case. And that way, no matter how high fluid pressure gets, let's say it gets up to 250, this spring still opens at 90. And the fluid at the top of that valve will be 90 psi always, unless actual fluid pressure is lower than 90. Maybe it's set at 30 or whatever. It's just a pressure regulator. So we have different pressures that we use throughout the transmission. It's not always the high line pressure. So some of those valves are pressure regulator valves. Some are shifting valves to upshift us and downshift us. Some of them are to control the flow of that torque converter clutch that we talked about on the Allison the other day. We've got another valve. It's buried up underneath. But as we move the gear selector, that valve is called the manual valve. We can't see it because it's covered up, but that manual valve routes fluid to these valves and solenoids so that they can be turned on and off to control the upshifting and downshifting. So all of these transmissions, I don't care what brand it is, even that Honda automatically shifted manual transmission over there still uses these types of valves and springs. They might be bigger, longer, multiple piece or whatever. They might have solenoids that are a whole bunch bigger than a little tiny one. They might have a whole solenoid pack on those 41 TEs that we did. Remember on the side of the transmission, you unbolted that big electrical thing? That's clear full of solenoids that controls that transmission. Okay, let me turn this transmission just a little bit more and show you a few other things. These, if you haven't looked at this transmission up to this point, all of this should look familiar. Starting back here, what's this? It's your parking gear. So your parking pawl is going to come in and engage that gear and keep it from rotating. And that's splined right to the output shaft, so it stops the drive shaft from turning, which stops the ring and pinion from turning, which stops the differential side gears and pinions from turning, which stops the axle shafts. And keeps the vehicle from moving as long as both wheels are on the ground. You ever had the misfortune of jacking up one wheel and the vehicle starts to roll? With an open differential, yeah. Okay, next to it, what's this? It's just a clutch pack. And notice it's splined to the case, so what's the job of that clutch pack versus a planetary gear set? It's a brake, it holds something from rotating. This one too, another clutch pack. If we go back here farther, can you see this is a piston right here? That's a piston. That's the piston seal ring. That piston reaches up over the parking gear and that's what's going to push on that clutch pack to apply it. So there's our little bit of end play. Remember, you're supposed to have some free play in the clutches. All your transmissions are going to have that. So here's another holding clutch. It has its own piston down inside of there. And then this would be the equivalent of that input housing. And inside of that input housing, we've got a couple of other clutch packs that are going to do the rotating of the planetary gear sets. But right here on this transmission, we have a part, and it's cut away, so it's kind of hard to see. But it's the band. This band acts as a brake, and there's a nice smooth surface right here that band is going to wrap itself around and stop it from rotating. And if we follow that, it comes clear over and goes down inside the transmission and actually hooks to a sun gear. So that band stops a sun gear that's deep down inside. And then this is an old three-speed Toyota transmission that they threw an overdrive unit in front of. So, sound familiar? there's another planetary gear set up front. So there's two in the back that give us our three speeds. And then there's one more that they put up front here that's either direct drive for first, second, and third gear, or it's overdrive when we go to fourth gear. So for fourth gear to happen, this transmission actually has to be in third back here, and then it spins it in overdrive in the front to spin the whole rest of the transmission. But it's just got another clutch pack, and notice it is also splined to the case, so it's a brake style clutch pack. All right, and then one more thing before we look at solenoid testing. Here on the side of the transmission, we've got these pistons with springs below them, and there's another one over here. Those are accumulators. And you've probably seen these weird little spring-loaded pistons throughout the transmission, on every transmission except the Allison. It doesn't have any. The job of an accumulator is to do what?
Soften the shift.
It affects shift quality. Think of them as a shock absorber for each shift. So I don't know which one is which, but let's say that... get my fingers right here. There we go. This one, let's say that's for the 1-2 shift. When that shift valve moves and sends fluid to whatever gives us second gear, to the piston that squishes the clutch pack to give a second gear, it also sends fluid to the top of this piston where it's going to push down against that spring, and it'll kind of give it a slight delay in the clutch apply. And that delay will be a kind of a cushiony delay because you're pushing against the spring. So that'll give you a nice soft shift. And there's a valve in the valve body called an accumulator valve that's actually going to control a fluid pressure that's back here with the spring also. And so if we have low fluid pressure, then the spring will be nice and cushy and give us a soft shift. But let's say we're at wide open throttle and we don't want a soft shift. You can't turn off the accumulator. The piston is still there, the spring's still there. So what they do is hydrostatically lock it in place. They fill this passage full of fluid and block it off from coming out. And that holds the piston solid. And so it is like turning off the accumulator piston. It just prevents it from moving. So then you get a nice solid shift. And that fluid pressure is variable. So wide open throttle, it's really hard. Half throttle, it's kind of somewhere in between. And at light throttle, it's just barely any fluid pressure at all. Every one of these transmissions, like I said, except the Allison, have those accumulators in it. The Allison doesn't have accumulators in it because it uses those pulse width modulated solenoids to shift the transmission. So besides the solenoid, besides having on-off solenoids, it has two pulse width modulated solenoids. And instead of having a high pressure that needs to be cushioned, it varies the pressure that actually applies the clutch instead. And that's the next evolutionary step in transmission control. Chrysler has the even next evolutionary step, the 545 and I believe the 62TE that we had apart here last week. A lot of those are eliminating the valves in the valve body itself. If you think about it, if we're using a solenoid to move a valve to let fluid go through, why not get rid of the valve and just put the solenoid there? Let the valve control the fluid going through the solenoid. When the solenoid's on, the fluid goes through and applies the clutch. When it's off, it doesn't. That's a pretty simple design. But that's how automotive evolution has been. They take something that they had the previous year, modify it a little bit to make it work with the new idea, and then keep changing it and changing it. So this is old school. All the newer transmissions, there's a GM 6T70 over there. That's the same way. It doesn't have, it still has some valves in the valve body for pressure regulation and manual valve and torque converter clutch control. But for the most part, the valves themselves do the shifting of the transmission.